Selamat pagi, salam hormat, salam sejahtera dan salam negaraku Malaysia. Firstly, I would like to express my appreciation for the warm welcome. Apa kabar semua? It gives me great pleasure to be back here again at UCSI University. I was given the honor last year where I spoke extensively on leading through innovation. And while today's topics differs greatly, I must stress that the need to lead and innovate applies more than ever as we prepare ourselves for the fourth industrial revolution, or Industry 4.0, a revolution that will change society, economy, and life as we know it. The theme of this conference, Shaping Malaysian Industry for the Fourth Industrial Revolution, is of utmost urgency for Malaysia to address the impact of the revolution in our industry, economy, and the competitiveness of the nation. Ladies and gentlemen, a revolution is defined as a possible overthrow of the current order in favor of the new system, of a new system. The world has undergone revolutions in the past, all driven by the disruption through technology, which led to growth and innovation. The first industrial revolution was brought upon production powered by steam and water engines. Second was driven by electricity, energy, and the third through electronics and information technology. The fourth industrial revolution is predicted to be unlike anything humankind has experienced before in terms of its scale, scope, and complexity. It will bring convergence of science, technology, and innovation that changes the way we live, work, communicate, and collaborate with one another. The fourth industrial revolution has set tipping point in science, technology, and innovation towards unprecedented advances. This fusing of the physical, digital, and biological world is a hallmark of the fourth industrial revolution, and it is impacting all disciplines, economies, and industries, and even challenging what it means to be human. Recent years have seen the advent of driverless cars such as Google's Chauffeur, IBM's Jeopardy beating computer, Watson, Baxter, a programmable robot, and detailed knowledge of the human genome providing new avenues for advances in medicine and biotechnology. So ladies and gentlemen, the goalposts have changed. Change is already here and more uncertainty will come. Talk to the mainstream media and taxi companies in Malaysia for clear views of the changes. Clarion calls have been alerted to our industry, manufacturing and services which have served as the backbone of the Malaysian economy. The impact will bring disruption in reshaping the manufacturing sector, long regarded as the backbone of the Malaysian economy. The manufacturing sector has a long and dominant in history in the Malaysian economy. From humble beginning in the 1960s, industrialization era, it has now the largest economic sector, accounting for 69 billion and contributing around 23% of the Malaysia's GDP. However, there is a strong need for manufacturing sector to evolve to higher value and in order to remain competitive. Globally, the manufacturing sector is rapidly transforming with the advent of the fourth industrial revolution. Breakthroughs in artificial intelligence, robotics, the Internet of Things, IoT, autonomous vehicles, 3D printing, nanotechnology, biotechnology, material science, energy storage, and quantum computing are propelling the manufacturing sector towards greater productivity and efficiency. Smart factories in which machines are augmented with web connectivity and integrated to a system that can visualize the entire production chain and make decision on its own is now a reality. The fourth industrial revolution holds both promise and peril for humanity. For example, with the rise of robots and thinking machines, how will future jobs be impacted? Automation will be the major disrupting factor that makes stable middle-class job obsolete. The role of the worker will no longer be sacrosanct with the rise of smart factories. In fact, it will be greatly diminished or even made redundant. This is a major challenge for my ministry because one of our biggest mandate is to create wealth and at the same time to create job. But as we advance in technology, we will do away with jobs. And the more I talk to university students, I had a dialogue with OPSI student a few days ago, and one of the greatest concerns for the student is job. And as we progress in the fourth industrial revolution, more jobs will be overtaken by automation. And at the same time, the job of the future, the job of those who are in year one, year two, in primary school today, doesn't exist yet. That is a major challenge for us. To make things clear, let us take a look at the $80 billion a year sports shoe industry that is dominated by Adidas and Nike. For decades, manufacturing has been offshored to countries like Malaysia, Indonesia, China, and Vietnam in effort to save production costs. But as labor becomes more expensive in developing nations, firms are turning to Industry 4.0 to revolutionize the operations. Adidas recently launched the Speed Factory in Germany, a smart factory that is virtually fully operated by robots and virtual computer modeling systems, employing additive manufacturing or 3D printing. The factory creates around 160 production jobs compared to thousands at typical offshore factory in Asia. Classified as a top secret facility, little is known about the smart factory apart from the fact that it can go from design to production immediately, shortening the supply chain and manufacturing time tremendously. For now, Adidas has said that the Speed Factory will complement its existing Asian operations and not compete with them. But as 3D printing advances and overheads rise, how long will it be before conventional factories are overruled in favor of the smart variants? And what will happen? What happens to the workers who are currently employed? What happens first in manufacturing will spill over in time to the service sector as new technologies that combine the physical, digital, and biological spheres before more functional and ubiquitous. And when that happens, we will be forced to change the way we perceive work. We may even be forced to change the way we interpret life. In 2013, a study by Oxford University estimated that up to 47% of jobs in the United States will be at risk from automation. Another survey in 2015 by McKinsey and Company showed the stark truth that only 48% of the US 300 manufacturing leaders consider themselves ready for Industry 4.0. If the world's leading economy and its industry champions are playing catch up, what about the rest of the world? What exactly does Malaysia stand? I'm often asked if Malaysia is ready to embrace the fourth industrial revolution. In my view, the question should instead be, what are we doing today to ensure that Malaysia succeeds in the fourth industrial revolution? So, ladies and gentlemen, when it comes to implementing ideas and creating value to realize innovation, the key factor is people at the heart of global networks. People are the prime movers of innovation. As such, I cannot overemphasize talent development. I have told this in many occasions, and I will state it here again. The new economy will be knowledge-driven and innovation-led, fueled by robust science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, STEM talents. The line between man and machine is getting blurred in this new revolution. According to the World Bank Group, 2/3 of all jobs could be susceptible to automation in developing countries in the coming decade. Another estimate by Forbes states that 47% of US jobs are at risk from automation. The requirements of jobs are shifting into expert knowledge versus catering for physically demanding roles. Machines are expected to fully take over the cumbersome, dangerous, and routine tasks as they would be able to deliver greater productivity and efficiency. As for the role of people, how would this change in the new operating landscape? The responsibilities will increasingly shift to knowledge work, process control, and decision making. In the agriculture sector, for example, with advancement of connectivity and technology, and we now have telephone farmers, where sensors are being deployed to measure water tank levels or the amount of moisture in the soil. All this data is streamed to the cloud, and farmers can access it through their mobile phone. The fourth industrial revolution will take farmers into an unprecedented new world where agriculture activities feed on data from GPS services and sensors to give farmers information on rainfall, crop yield, pest infection, and soil nutrition. This will result in better productivity and less waste of resources. As such, to work in the agriculture sector does not mean that one has to be a farmer. Instead, there is a need for sensor specialists, network engineers, or biotechnology experts. Emerging technologies and new operating systems require the development of a knowledge-based, high-skilled talent pool. Having the best technologies of the fastest internet connection would be meaningless if we do not possess the right talent to harness them. While the internet is a powerful enabler for people to connect and collaborate, we cannot stop at only developing infrastructure, but invest in ensuring that people are empowered through knowledge, creativity, skills, networks, values to bring about disruptive innovation. Higher education must purposefully facilitate this. In order to remain competitive, our industries must embrace Industry 4.0 and our talent must move to the knowledge paradigm. This calls for shaping of a new mindset and sharpening of skill sets. According to Infosys, survey in 2015 of young people in 9 industrial nations, 70% reported being prepared to learn a whole new skill set to get a job. Do our young people have the same attitude? Can they be reskilled? Young people are often to change and prepared to embrace the idea of demand learning and personal flexibility, but they must be rightly facilitated and nurtured to acquire the knowledge, skills, and experience needed to succeed in the fourth industrial revolution. The workforce of 2050 will be made up of today's Generation Z or Gen Z, the post-millennials and Generation Alpha, Gen Alpha, comprising those born from 2010 onwards. Technology is defining factor for Gen Z and Gen Alpha. Gen Alpha is predicted to be the most educated generation ever, the most technology supplied generation ever, and the generation with the greatest wealth at their disposal. When they enter the workforce, spatial cognition and robotics and artificial intelligence will be a commonplace. Are our youths and young children being prepared for the future now? Will what they are being taught or learning today be relevant then? In the book, The Industries of the Future, the author Alex Ross emphasizes the importance of investing in nurturing a creative and entrepreneurial spirit among the young generation. We need them to become job creators, not just job seekers. Now, we have been talking about this, and my colleague, Idris Joso of Mohe, is propagating this and is taking roots in the universities. But every time I have a dialogue with students, I find that this is easier said than done. It is very, very challenging. Students in the public university especially, they think that the industry must be set up, it must be organized by government and not driven by entrepreneurs. And that in itself is a major challenge for us. So, does our system support risk-taking, for instance? Are those who fail encouraged to learn from mistakes, improve and not quit? We need such an ecosystem to enable STI-based startups to flourish. The entrepreneurial development, startups and the like, must be allowed and must be given room to experiment and to fail. There must be no pressure to succeed. I'm not ashamed to share that in the 10 Malaysia plan, for all the funds given away by mostly to researchers, research universities, institutes and the like, we have created something like 1,700 projects, research projects. And we are now in the 11 Malaysia plan, and we still have almost 600 uncompleted research projects. And what I have seen in the market out of those research is not even up to 20 out of 1,700. So we must allow for experimentation and failures and things like that. And those who are going into entrepreneurship must be given that room, that entrepreneurship is one of the most challenging thing on earth, I think. It's not easy to make money. Institutions of higher learning have a very important role to play in shaping young people for the future of learning and the future work. This is perhaps the reason President Obama challenged US educators to go beyond measuring students' cognitive ability to assessing if they pass 21st century skills such as problem solving, critical thinking, entrepreneurship, and creativity. We need to invest in nurturing the workforce of the future, in particular by developing science, technology, engineering, mathematics, STEM talent. It has to be talent by design and not by chance. I have been talking about this, and as I say again, it's easier said than done. There are a lot more challenges. In this country, we used to do streaming of the sciences and the arts, and the better students go to science. But there's more and more calls that I'm hearing that there shouldn't be any streaming. Even the good ones should not necessarily do science, and that all kinds of debates, all kinds of ideas. But the point is, I think there's no two way about it. We have to embrace STEM. And I, for one, will continue to advocate that 60% of our students must take up science, as has been said, as the policy has been said ever since 1967. So, ladies and gentlemen, the new economy that underpinned the fourth industrial revolution has brought about a paradigm shift from being resource-focused to being knowledge-intensive, labor-intensive, to high-skilled talents, requiring collaboration, vertical to horizontal, trust orientation, mass production to mass customization, proximity focus to location becoming less significant, rigidity to flexibility, and knowledge transfer to knowledge sharing. This is the age of collaboration. Gone were the days when the entrepreneur, who is the first to acquire technology and hope to succeed in their business. Yeah, I mean, you have bread. Scholars today are saying that it's no longer the technology, but it's about business model. The premise of control and conquer is no longer relevant. Today, it is about platform, networks, and connectivity in a shared value ecosystem. The rise of the collaborative economy is demonstrated by examples such as Uber, the world's largest transportation company, Airbnb, the world's largest hotelier, Alibaba, the world's largest retailer, and many others. The information and communication technology, ICT, revolution has made the collaborative economy not only possible, but economically viable. ICT has enabled effective engagement and collaboration to form mutually supporting value-creating systems. Ultimately, the collaborative economy is a socio-economic system built upon resource sharing in supply and value chains that empower all participants in the quadruple helix through ICT-enabled networks to produce high value-added goods and services. So as we usher the fourth industrial revolution, we need to synergize the different aspects to deliver value for the nation and people. We need dynamic collaborative platform across sectors and regions to generate impact. The theme of this conference that focuses on strengthening industry-academia partnership is much needed. This is also subject matter. This is something that is close to the heart of my ministry, and we have been talking about this, and we have been looking at various models of how to resolve this. And so we must foster closer linkages for demand-driven R&D and market-driven delivery system. In a recent study mandated by the National Science Council, chaired by the Prime Minister, the Academy of Sciences Malaysia, and the National Professors Council, proposed collaborative networks as the mechanism to leverage new economic opportunities in emerging markets. The benefits of collaborative networks are multifaceted, such as breaking down traditional barriers to interactions, creating new markets for our innovation, enabling development of our new knowledge, sharing knowledge leading to the formation of knowledge clusters, enabling non-conventional institutional arrangement that defy traditional hierarchies, among others. Three key success factors for collaborative network to drive value creations are leadership is very, very critical, effective collaborative strategies, and knowledge intensiveness. We need to ensure enabling ecosystem for Malaysia to prosper in the fourth industrial revolution. This requires everyone to come together and play their part. communication and collaboration must become the order of the day. That's the reason why we are taking a lot of initiative, a lot of effort to do science communication. We want to communicate science. And in an environment where we are overloaded with information, this has been very, very challenging to find a niche to communicate the sciences and the technology that we would like to communicate to the people. So ladies and gentlemen, we need to raise our game to be competitive. Knowledge is the currency of the new economy. We have said this again and again. As such, in order to bring the Malaysian economic sectors to the next level, we must ensure the proliferation of knowledge-intensive enterprises that leverage on science and technology. This will ensure disruptive innovation by our enterprises. Again, this is very challenging. I have gone, I have gone down to Turun Padang and went to see some of the things that our innovators are doing. And there are a lot of challenges, but as I said, we must allow for experimentation, we must allow for failures. What is important is we must keep on doing it, we must keep on trying. So under my leadership in the ministry, I'm positioning the Ministry of Science, Technology, Innovation mostly to be the backbone for Malaysia's sustainable economic growth as we navigate through the fourth industrial revolution. This is going to be very, very challenging, but we have to start from somewhere. So mostly through the Academy of Sciences Malaysia is also developing a national STM master plan that will serve as an overarching strategic plan for STI in the nation for the long term for 2020 to 2030. Such an STI master plan would articulate the vision, the target, policy measures, mechanisms, and synergistic action plans across all ministries and sectors to advance STI in Malaysia. It will be a crucial governance tool to harmonize, consolidate, and focus all of the nation's STI-related initiatives in consonant with the national aspiration to become a high-income developed nation with an innovation-led economy and to be the top 20 nation by 2050. This is just said and done. I do understand that it takes visionary and strong leadership to consolidate existing resources and create collaborative collaborations where necessary. Sirim Berhad, an agency under my ministry, is facilitating SMEs through advisory services and assistance in a program called Sirim Fraunhofer. They do technology audit and then thereafter propose innovative technology that will increase efficiency and productivity. And Sirim have carried out technology audit on something like 360 SMEs and has found that most of these companies were still at the industry 2.0 level. The company has since introduced new processes, technology and products to about 60 to 70 of these companies to help them move forward. And mind you, when you talk about change, even we do this audit, as Sirim, you know, engage these companies, some of them, or many of them are skeptical. They are still protective of their secret, that their technology, or whatever they are doing. And as I said, you see, this is a measure of where they are in the whole value chain of revolution development. Yeah. So believe me when I say, Malaysia has all the right components to ride with the giants in the current wave of the fourth industrial revolution. We have a talent base, infrastructure, funding system, and natural resources. In shaping a Malaysia of tomorrow, firstly, the old mode of thinking and working must be cast away. I suppose this is the first that we have to address, the mindset. As Albert Einstein once said, we cannot solve problems by using the same kind of thinking we use when we created them. It has to be a new set of thinking, totally new set of thinking. The challenge is to migrate to the new way of doing things rapidly enough to increase innovation capacity to create significant impact. So it is time to recognize this and take action. In order to remain competitive in the fourth industrial revolution, we need to understand the forces of change and facilitate the development of talents for the future and knowledge enterprises by STI that can prosper in a diverse world. Every time I have a dialogue, either with the industry, the researchers and students in the universities, I'm always being presented. He said, YB, you have been talking about technology, you have been talking about all these changes, and recently talking about ransomware and things like that. And he said, look, my people from Sabah and Sarawak will say, hey, YB, kampung saya belum ada elektrik lagi. Mau tunggu sampai pilihan raya bila mana. I knew you're talking about ransomware that's totally alien to us. I say, hi, I'm not even talking about ransomware, I'm also talking about ransom war. It's going to infect your computers, you know. So wherever you are, you could be somewhere in Lubukantu, you could be somewhere in Nabawan, Pensiangan, but for as long as you own a PC, you are vulnerable to malware, ransomware. Nobody's going to be spared. So what it means is that, yes, they have this continual development from the remotest kampung to the most developed Kuala Lumpur, but we have to do it in parallel. We have to address all the concerns as we go along. So, ladies and gentlemen, with that, I would like to wish you all success in your deliberation at the conference. And once again, I would like to thank UCASI for inviting me to this forum. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Yang Berhormat Dato' Sri.